I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, so as folks can see, we have a guest at the table, our rising superintendent.
Oh gosh, that sounds exciting.
Is that how you pronounce it?
That's exciting.
Relatively new, I took that phrase relatively, our incoming superintendent, Bob Godomsky, who will be starting officially July 1st, but is taking the opportunity to get to know the communities and the boards a little better as he steps into it.
Thank you for having me.
Would you like to say anything?
I'm just looking forward to the next 5 weeks moving along and getting down here and starting things in place. So I appreciate the opportunity to come and be part of your meeting tonight and learn a little bit more about Rollins.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Any comments from visitors? Any item on the agenda? All right, seeing no comments, we will move forward to the consent calendar. The consent calendar this month has on it our minutes from last month, the letter that we all received from the Rollins for Education Association, the extended days, the extended time each day to make up for the snow days, and May enrollment. What's the pleasure of the board on the consent calendar?
I'll make a motion to accept the consent calendar.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Announcements. Are there any announcements?
A couple of things to share with everyone tonight. And some of these things I won't dwell on because some of them are in Kate's report as well. And we're still waiting to get word on that, on those the public infrastructure security grants. Rollins is still on the wait list. I think they're still trying to navigate through. There's also talk about a new allocation at some point, another $10 million that they're looking at, but whether that, how that dovetails all in and whether that will be approved, there's a lot of question, I think, at this point about where that will all go and whether that will be approved. But at this point, those projects for Rollins would have not received support, waitlisted.
We're still waiting.
Yes. Oh, yes, absolutely. They were not denied. They're just looking to see. There's about $100,000 left. So I think they're looking to see how people are using. So, like, the ones for some of what I sat down and, like, okay, so we're not going to use the total allocation for some of the projects. So I think that's what they're looking for. So, but I'm not sure how long you want to wait. And I think that's one of the things Kate's looking for.
Yes, and I've already told Katie I have a question I'll be asking her when we get to the point that sort of relates to this as well.
Right. So the other thing we've talked about for the last few months, and we still don't have full direction, and I'm not sure, I think we will soon, is around Title I. You know, we've talked about that, and the reduction, the fewer students that receive free and reduced lunch. We're still waiting to get the word. None of those allocations have come out yet, so we're still waiting to see. Which is frustrating because it's hard to plan ahead and you don't know, how much, you're going to have to do for adjustments.
And we're waiting to see what the final
whether or not you're
decision
actually
is, whether you get any or
exactly.
or how much lower. Or
no. Yeah. Right. So the other thing is some happy news. This is Teacher Appreciation Week. This is usually a week that teachers put on a pound or two because they get to be fed. So I know there's been a lot of things. I was here at RGS yesterday. There were balloons out front and all sorts of things. And so I know there's been a lot of support. And it's always a fun week for the schools to take a pause and recognize their teachers. And then I had the opportunity, is that Wednesday?
Yesterday.
It's been a busy day, or Tuesday perhaps, to go over to Summersworth High School and recognize the top 10 students. And your own Kate is this year's class valedictorian.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. well at graduation next month, so. And like you said, you know, as we know, Bob's here. He and I have talked a lot and, you know, working on the transition. And so it's exciting, and I'll be looking forward to having a partner in crime, so I'm back into the music world.
Excellent, thank you. This is as good a time as any. I'm going to take the announcement time. This is likely my last board meeting of the school year, because as all of you know, at least I have on vacation and plan to be away. So I'm going to take this opportunity to say a few words about Kate Lucas. Principal Lucas is above all else an educator. It's not just a job for Kate, it's a passion and a calling. In the 7 years she's been principal of RGS, she oversaw enormous changes. RGS is a recognized leader in inquiry-based education today, due in large part to Kate's energy and leadership. Every staff member, whether teacher, para, nurse, custodian, staff, or volunteer, and Principal Lucas herself, was challenged and supported to become what was needed to challenge and support every student to understand what it means to think, to reason, to learn. Kate has been a real partner with the board when it comes to making good decisions about the school building. She never complained to us about the very real constraints around providing a 21st century education in a very early 20th century building. Her philosophy, it seemed, although she never actually stated it that I remember, was that as long as students and staff were safe and the building posed no threats, we all remember the asbestos that we believe we have eradicated, she could work around the other physical constraints of classrooms that are too small, no lunchroom, and no space for working with individual students. Every year, little spaces got carved out and rearranged and repurposed. And under her watch, RGS became a state and national historic landmark. I could go on much longer, but I know we have business to conduct. I'll end by quoting an op-ed piece from the New York Times of March 13th of this year. Principals set the culture by their behavior. The message is the person. Today's successful principals are high energy types, constantly circulating through the building, offering feedback, setting standards, applying social glue. Principals raise expectations and alter norms. The character traits successful principals embody and spread are energy, trustworthiness, honesty, optimism, and determination. That's an end quote from the article. Thank you, Kate, for your constant pursuit of learning. Learning for your students, for your colleagues, and maybe most importantly, for yourself. One of the things I will always remember you for is your willingness to talk education, not just administration as a principal, each and every day. Thank you. You'll be missed. Indulging me to do that. Done since I won't be around next time. No communications, I assume. Okay. All right, discussion items. We have the principal's update. I, for one, enjoyed seeing the calendar. And being the not necessarily detailed oriented person I should be, I wondered why we were doing testing on Sundays.
University.
I see now that I'm back and
fill it in every day.
And see that we're not doing testing on Sundays. Are there parts that you would like to talk about now and some that we may have to do
in
other sections?
I think the most discussion items, we could probably wait until that unless you guys have questions for me. Okay.
It is interesting to note how much time, 3 weeks of testing. It's an incredible amount of time, and I've been learning and doing a lot more reading on the value of such testing. But anyway, it is interesting to know how much time it takes. All right, we'll move on then. I don't see Noah here, so we will move on to the valedictorian. Some of our senior class represented baby
So our student council is celebrating teacher appreciation. So we've given some punny gifts, like little markers that say you're remarkable, little Kit Kats that say you need a break, things like that. We've also done staff superlatives of the student council members as well as other staff have voted on things like most likely to, forget to attendance was one, I think. Just like little things like that to kind of keep it light and just celebrate each other for our quirks and everything that makes us who we are. We've also done a teacher breakfast, and then tomorrow, this is the second time we've done this, we're doing like a celebration journal, as we call it. So we sent out, student council sent out a form, a Google form to every member in the building, just encouraging them to send a little one-liner about someone that's made an impact on them and something that they've done, even if it seems seemingly insignificant, just something that they've done that they really take it to heart. So that is being published tomorrow, and that's always a really nice thing to see, so we're excited for that. Next week, we're doing our Spring Spirit Week, and we're also planning our annual State House trip, which is where, on the state level, the student council offices are filled at that election time. Our National Honor Society chapter has finished election, so all of our new offices are filled. For the first time since I've been in the high school, we've had a tie for presidency. So that's all sorted out now. That was interesting. And then we're also planning a teen night, because something that we kind of set as like an end goal for the year is to become closer as a unit and kind of end all divides between different classes or whatever it may be. So we're planning like a teen night like a sports team would have. We're also volunteering at UNH's commencement on May 19th, and we also have our last soup kitchen of the year on June 13th, and we're doing a senior celebration after that, celebrate the senior members of NHS. As far as our classes are concerned, the freshmen are hoping to have a car wash on this Saturday, May 12th from 11 to 4 at VIP Auto in Summersworth, so they're permitting. Sophomore class is working with their new advisor going into their junior year. They're very excited to see what new opportunities that will bring. And then the junior class is super focused on prom. Their prom is May 19th, and Grand March will be at 4:30. And then the senior class is working on finishing up senior banquet. Tickets will be sold for $45 beginning next Monday. We're also finalizing plans for project graduation, which is what will follow graduation. We're planning baccalaureate with Reverend Rideout from First Parish Church. We're also finalizing senior gifts. With sports, baseball and softball have their next game home against Newfound on Monday at 4, and then the track team has their next meet at Timberlane next Wednesday at 4, and then the last thing is that AP exams have begun. The first test that people took was yesterday for the AP literature exam, and then next week we have AP calculus and AP stats, so that's where we're at.
Busy times. And when is your last day?
I have finals the 13th and 14th of June, and then I graduate. So, yeah.
Well, it's wonderful. So will you be able to join the board on at our June meeting, or are you planning to join us or not? I mean, quite often you graduate.
I think so, unless another date pops up.
Yes,
I think.
Well, we appreciate all of your service for all of the years that you've been coming and keeping us updated. As usual, you're welcome to stay, but I know how busy you must be this time of year, so thank you very much for your
nothing.
Celebrating.
Yes,
yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Have a nice night.
Just a quick addition. At the SAU board meeting on Monday, none of the Rollinsford members were able to run themselves for the SAU chair. Tom was absent, and I always feel it's a little dicey to elect someone in absentia. So, Tom, I believe you are willing to accept this honor of being the SAU chair.
I didn't want to overstep you. I know you were excited about the prospect, but yes, I'll accept it if forced.
I believe that will be done officially at the next, in September, which is our next SAU board meeting. So officially, that's when it will
try to make it.
Take
who would be the vice chair?
Mark
Richardson.
Mark Richardson. Do you know Mark? I'm just getting to know him.
He was on the board a number of years ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well,
yes. Yes, one of my generation.
What is that?
No hippie, but like some of us. Thank you.
Right on.
Thank you, Tom. That's appreciated. So.
I don't think we have any action items because I think they're listed under new business, some of the things we have to take. Does that sound right? So we'll just keep moving along. Budget. Budget. Katie?
It's in your packet. A couple of things I wanted to know. I think I mentioned the last time, special ed transportation, we hadn't received a lot of the bills.
Yes.
So I went through and I figured out which bills we have paid. We're looking at another additional $62,000 in sped transportation. I sent this to Pam McDonald, our special ed director, to take a look at it and just make sure that I'm factoring everything correctly, which is going to put those lines over budget by about $36,000.
Okay, but just the special
ed transportation.
Yes. Okay.
So when you're looking at the total available balance, another $66,000 is going to come off of that for transportation.
Yep.
However, looking at the most recent Marshwood SPED bill for tuition and services, I was able to release about $11,000 for some services or students that are no longer there.
Okay, so, about $11,000.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the net would be about $51,000, $52,000. Mm-hmm. So, also, we had talked last time about the after-school transportation for Marshwood. I reached out to them.
Yes.
He said we wouldn't get a bill until the end of the year. They
okay.
go once a year for that, and it won't be until the end of the year. So we will be getting one. End of the school year, yeah.
Right. And we're so we really have no idea if we're on budget or not,
no,
do we?
No.
All right. Well, we'll discuss that as we go forward.
But we know the total amount that they will be charging us, no?
No. Because there may have been days the bus didn't run, which means I think we're charged a daily rate. Is
yes.
that correct?
Yes.
And so we don't know the days they run and don't run. So we don't really know, I don't think.
We can make a gross estimate.
You budgeted $5,000.
Which is why we budgeted $5,000.
Yeah. Because you didn't know at that time, I don't believe. I think that's just a number you
can. Do we think it's going to go over that?
I have no idea because I haven't received anything from them.
I think last year it was very close.
All right.
What is the daily fee?
I have to look it up.
What is it? Go over the million. It was a couple level because you budgeted for what it would be if you had it 3 days a week.
So I'm not sure that they did, though. I'm not sure that that's how it was budgeted.
It's 4 days a week. Anyway, we'll find out and we'll.
Yeah.
All right.
I think they did ballpark it. I'm not sure it was an exact amount.
Yeah.
I mean, 5,000 seems like a.
We were very close. It was like like 4,900
yeah,
something
yeah,
last
yeah.
year, as I recall. I did not bring last year's budget. I could avoid.
Other than that, I don't have much of an update.
All right. I have a couple of questions, and for clarity, as we look at the bottom line. Now, one of them, and you mentioned, of course, that the grant funds, the grants we applied for the work we wanted to have done here in the building, they're not coming through. So one of the questions, and I asked Katie earlier, so she helped me figure out how to sort of word this question, is if those grant funds come. So a couple of questions. If we go ahead with the projects, which we have to discuss with the board, and I believe we felt they were worthy enough to go forward with, and then grant money becomes available, will we still qualify for the grant money if we've already done and paid for the work?
You have to pay for it, though.
We have to pay for the whole thing up front anyway, right?
So okay, it's a reimbursement, so it's not. You know, in substitution of funds, it's a reimbursement of
okay.
funds you spend.
All right, so that's so likely so. And what if they don't distribute it until
that's
the next school
said.
Year? Then what happens? Because then we've expended the money in one school year,
right.
and we.
Well, and I said to Judy, I wasn't sure if they would retro. Like, if you spent it this year and you don't get approved for it until next year, will they retroactive it to? Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
If you've already completed the project. That I would have to reach out to Amy and ask her.
All right. I think we'd.
I don't know.
It's probably.
I mean, I know step one on the form when you submit reimbursement, the first thing is you have to complete the project. That's the first thing. So
we can go.
The total cost.
But I would just want to clarify before we went ahead and completed it and then asked for the reimbursement that they would in fact pay the bills.
As we look at the budget, and I have another question on as we look at our budget and where we stand with it. we can afford to do those projects. They're about $63,000 in total. They were worthy enough for us to, they were on our list anyway, and the fact that we didn't get grants, I think we added one extra one because we would likely qualify for the grant, but we can still afford to do it this year.
And Judy, can you just remind us, some of that is already encumbered because we have given authority to
encumber that. $30,000 might already be encumbered.
Yeah, so I think you're right.
Because the phones.
Yes.
The doors.
I think it was well over $30,000 encumbered already.
I think you're right.
Which means that's already taken out of adjusting by $60,000.
It's really already encumbered another 35 or so. Anyway, I think we can take whatever action we need to, I think, to make sure that the work goes forward.
So let me just set some clarification on the grants. So we've already put in for the grants, and it's just a matter of the timing of when those grants are approved.
Well, what happened was the DOE, they added a, they kept pushing, and said, you know, get grants in. Right. And, you know, they extended the date, so, you know, Kate got the grant in well within the deadline that we were given. However, I think they got inundated with grants. And so then the DOE then came up with a, I will call it an arbitrary date, because it was never a date that had been made public, February 28th. And so projects that met that date were funded, or at least partially, or at least considered. So the one from Rollinsford did not come in until after that, even though, again, the dates that we were given for deadlines, they came back. So that's frustrating. So now they've been put on a wait list. So it's not that they wouldn't support it, because we've had, there are other projects when you look at this list that have not been approved. We had one in Summersworth that wasn't approved. So they've already vetted it in that respect. So I think they will approve it if they have the funds, but they just don't have that yet. And I think they're looking to see, because, you know, a number of these projects go through a process like an SB2 process, you know, so it's different than, the, as you know, the city structure around approvals of projects and things like that. So they're looking for, are people going to be able to do these projects or not? So I think that's where they are at. So that's, I don't know if that helps.
Yeah. I think I was concerned that we would do these, you know, thinking they're approved, they're ready to go, based on what you were saying, one of the earlier meetings, that, you know, we need to get these requests in ASAP, but now it's just there's a huge delay. But there's no, is there a concern that there won't be any funds available at the end?
Well, they did. So they, I think, again, yes. They've seen the same thing. You know, I don't know if you folks put in any in SC44, but I think, again, they were like blanketed. I mean, they put it out there and really, and, you know, and encouraged people to put in for, you know, some pretty substantial projects. And, you know, there was one we put in for someone's worth a $900,000 ask. And we were encouraged to do so by the department, and then we ended up getting $100,000. So I think there were a number of projects, so they wanted to try to meet as many needs as possible. And a lot of the projects were smaller. I would say they were between $20,000 and probably $60,000. And then there was another category that were, you know, up towards $100,000, and then there were some much bigger ones. So I think they just saw what they had, and then they tried to, you know, spread the wealth, if you will. So it's frustrating though, because you have this end date with your budget, and so I don't know how that would function as a
I think it would depend on the timing, because if it came in July and we were able to, then you could apply it back to before the audit. But if it doesn't come until
September,
then your audit is completed and the year is closed out, you wouldn't be able to apply it back to last year. So I'm not sure how that would work.
So can we find out those dates, and then, you know, that may be help us make decisions of when, if it makes sense, if it means a matter of moving things to happen later or July.
Well, I see what you're saying.
Incurring it for this year. I mean, if it can be done that way, if it makes sense, if we can. You know,
but we can't, because then even our match comes out of next year's budget if we do that. that. So that, and next year's budget is already, we already, I think, are, we're going to hear that, I think we're going to have some other pulls on next year's budget.
Well, I mean, it's not as though these things are important, or we want to do, so, you know, we should just do them, and we're going to have to somehow factor in. Because we know that folks are going to look and say, well, you're using this as a savings because we got the money back, but it's not. We really have to make sure that we word it that, you know, all this, this number reflects a potential grant reimbursement, so that there isn't, so there's no misunderstanding.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good point, yeah.
Because we can't, we're not going to say, well, we've saved, needed, because we got this money back. This was a grant, so.
And it was work we knew, we wanted to do. We did add in an extra project, but, and we can look at that more closely at some point as we get there, but. I have a couple.
Public money here.
Yeah, so other questions on the grant, folks?
I just feel we should move forward with those projects either way. They're important, safety and security wise, and.
Yeah, well, I'm very happy if people want to propose a motion right now to say that we go forward with all the projects that were listed for a total of 63. I forget what we've already encumbered, but to encumber the extra 30 to do that.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second.
And yet, any further discussion on that?
Just one comment. I think the important question really is, if you're going to move forward and do these anyway, if they're important enough to do that, the one question I would try to get clarification, they'll answer it or not, from the DOE, is that if you do the projects now, if you're off the wait list in, let's say, August or September, and they get the funding then, can you retroactively charge that?
Right.
Because I'm not sure. They're saying there's a 16 to 18 month window for reimbursement to do the projects, but I'm not sure what technically they're going to support if you do the project first and then come off the wait list.
But if
that's the project, really yeah.
That.
Correct me if I'm wrong, I'm hearing you say regardless, you need to do it. So it would be great to know that answer, but even if they don't retroactively, you want to do it as a board. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, and we know that for at least half of them, for at least half of the money, we knew we were going to do the project even before we knew there was a grant.
And you're going to do it on this year's budget?
Yeah, this year's budget. Okay. And looking at our bottom line, it looks like we can relatively easily do them all, and they are all important.
But I think all of these projects that we talked about, including the dollars, were included in that list, so they already have that queue. It's not as though we've added something else or switched it. You know, while we're doing something else instead, we'll take money for that. Now, these projects have already been, you know, listed. The money's earmarked just for those things. So, does that matter?
I mean, they continue to say that if you're waitlisted, they think that there's going to be money from approved projects that are underspent. Projects that did not get passed in the SB2 towns, that money's becoming available. And then they continue to talk about additional funds that they're looking for to put in there. So I don't think anybody can answer right now whether the waitlist projects are going to get it or not, or when, but they're saying there's a pretty good chance that the waitlist projects are going to get funded. I'm not getting any more definite than that.
That's the thing. I mean, if you feel like you're like half a step ahead of you in this process. So I think it's first time. I think they're just trying to figure out. I mean,
I've got two projects on the way there.
They moved the goalposts, though, with the.
I know, and that's the thing. It was frustrating.
But I think to everybody else's point, these are projects we want to do, we need to do. So regardless, if we get the money back, it will be a gift.
Any further discussion? Then all in favor of covering the full amount of what the grant would have covered, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Go ahead.
Question. Mm-hmm. Encumbering the funds doesn't mean that we're hiring someone to do the job. Should we do that?
Well, now that we've encumbered the funds and said go ahead, they will be put
the summer.
Okay.
I believe that's the process, correct?
Some of the ones that are bigger will go out and get people to come in and give us different estimates, try to get two or three, depending. Some of the jobs, there aren't two or three people that are, as we know, willing to even do the work, but we'll put those together and then ask people to give us estimates more, you know, to repeat a little bit, and then we'll go ahead and schedule.
Okay. A couple other budget questions. The warrant article passed that should we have up to $75,000 into our building reserve fund. That has not yet been encumbered though, correct? Okay, so that would come out of what's left there. So the other question is that the warrant article to create a tuition fund also passed. We are the keepers of that tuition fund. Does that mean, and this is a question that I have no idea about the answer to, does that mean that should there again be money available at our next meeting to put some money into that tuition fund, can we do that?
No, it has to be put on the warrant to put money into
it. No, it does not. We're the keepers. I don't think so. We're the keepers of it.
Spend out of it. I'm not sure about putting money
okay.
into
That's
it.
A good point.
You have to look at the wording of the warrant, but
okay.
I believe you are the keepers to expend from it. But I'm pretty sure if you want to put money into it, you have to put it on
okay.
the warrant.
And that could be, I was just curious about that.
Mm-hmm.
Because
we put a dollar.
You put a dollar to create the fund.
Oh,
I'm pretty sure you would have
dollar.
To put it on again in March
okay.
next year to
Thank
add
you.
Money out of your. Yeah.
I just wasn't sure. It would have been
so you take money out or put money on, perhaps.
Well, we'll find out. We'll find out how it's worded. I didn't look it up, but that was a question. Okay. All right. Okay. So again, speaking to the board again, I think at this point it looks like another 52, 62, plus the 75. You know, we're not going to be. We still have some wiggle room there. In this year's budget, not everything has been encumbered, so we haven't seen all the expenses that are coming in. I think it's right now it looks like still looks like a very high amount left there, but it's not as we look at it more closely. So just
making those utilities and things,
yeah.
You know, regular monthly bills. You know, there's still I added up there's still about 19 or 20,000 in your regular lines here at the school. You know, so there's still money there.
Yeah, to come out,
yeah.
to come out, yes, and there always is. And last year, you may remember, we did not keep our full 2.5% that we were allowed to keep for emergencies. We took a lesser amount in order to give more back to the town for school tax reduction. So, again, I think we'll probably be in pretty good shape to do some of that this year too, to return money for tax reduction. But we'll see how that goes. Any other questions or comments on the budget?
Sorry. There was another question I'll make too. So one of the things we talked about at last month's meeting was Title I resources.
Yes.
And we decided we would wait until, or you guys decided to wait until the May meeting to see if there's any new information coming from the state. unfortunately, there isn't. And my impression is talking to Caroline is that she doesn't feel positively about it. Okay. I just want to make sure I'm reading.
No, you're absolutely correct.
And so, you guys had already voted on next year, or had talked, I shouldn't say voted, you talked about a literacy tutor next year, because we will be losing our Title I tutor, and we would have no Tier 2 support for our students in literacy. You had also talked about using, if there was funds at the end of the year, to purchase some of the Title I materials that we're going to have to box up. And my concern is it's the May school board meeting, and we haven't talked about it further, only because we would need to purchase those materials sooner rather than later, and then post for a position if that's the case. And I believe even if we get any Title I dollars, it will be minimal, like very minimal.
Do we know the cost of the materials?
Yes. So I met with Shauna and Amy, and we pulled together like the bare minimum. This is not all of the Title I materials, but it's enough that we could still perform the interventions. It's $12,773. It's your benchmarking, which you need to do with all your students. It's the LLI system, which is the intervention systems. And then it's some of the stuff that we send home with families to support their children at home. I can give you details. I only have one copy, but I can give you details.
And
this is the price that, where is the federal government or whoever puts on these?
This is, no, the company that owned them, so the actual printing, so some of this is Pearson, some of this is Fudge and Pennell, it's their cost of things.
Let me just say, there was nothing you could work with the state.
I know, I'm gonna ask this.
There's nothing we can work with the state with.
So there's no renting program?
No renting.
Love a rent, we can rent your.
Yeah, it's for years to home.
The frustrating thing about it is, they can be boxed up for a year, because if the following year you, your numbers increase again, then you can have access to those materials. That leaves us a year without those materials, which is not an acceptable answer. From my opinion, educationally, that's not an acceptable answer to do without those resources for a year. The frustrating part is that then you may have access to them in a year, right? I just have no way of predicting that, and our number changed so dramatically this year, and there isn't any town data that's showing us that it's going to change either. So it's hard. We're in a tough position this year, unexpectedly.
So if we have, you said if we get any help, just a little bit.
We could access the materials.
If we get a little bit, we can access the materials.
Caroline Butler's telling us that. I feel bad because I feel like I'm misleading you. Caroline is very clear that we're not going to.
Right.
But, and she's been told we're not, but they're like, well, you could try back again. It's just really, I don't want to.
I think they were going to check into whether that hold harms provision had been.
But they thought it had been removed.
Right.
So that it wouldn't help us.
So that's, I think that was one of the pieces.
It was like a caveat. We were kind of hoping it would be, and it just hasn't, at this time, May 10th, we haven't heard any.
But even if you got $1,000,
we have access to the materials. Yes.
So that's something that then we could discuss and make a motion on, and then obviously if we got $1,000, then we wouldn't have to.
I mean, realistically, we wouldn't have to order these until June 29th, right? I mean, that's, you could say you could approve it tonight and then not order them until.
Be a little leery of
okay,
that.
June 20th.
That's your support of the same materials to go for next
okay,
year
so
for auditing. I'm just going to throw that up there.
May 30th.
Such a rule follower.
Sorry. I'm the one that has the answer to them, not you.
So if you order them and they come and you don't open them and then you don't need them, can you send them back? Is it like Amazon? Is it send them back?
Maybe. I can find that out for you. I don't really know the answer to that.
But aren't we also, in a sense, buying them for next year? If we buy,
yeah, so
we
there's
buy
a little more leeway if you buy them in May.
Right.
Or not June 29th, because school is already let out.
Right.
So
we are often cautioned by our business administrator to not make any major purchases after May.
Okay.
Because it doesn't look good to the auditors.
It'll show up on your audit.
Yes.
Yeah. So if we do end up getting $1,000 and we can't access these materials and we have purchased these others, are they still useful to us?
Sure, absolutely.
I mean,
definitely.
We would just have extra.
Well, yeah, they're extra. We would use them, certainly. We just we don't need them. You know what I mean?
Right.
We have what we need right now.
But like, instead of kids like sharing something, everyone would have their own. Is that a thing? Or?
No, it's not. These are more like materials for when you're working with the children. They're not sort of. And Title One is small groups, so we have enough to go around. It's not like a
right.
classroom set of something. It's not like that. And the benchmark system is a one-on-one, so it's not quite like that. If it was classroom materials, absolutely.
Right.
It's just not. It's a different delivery
right.
service.
So, are the materials of any use if we don't have a Title One tutor? Or
no, but we had discussed last month
yes.
that you would be hiring a literacy tutor next
a literacy
year
tutor.
If we did
yes.
not get a Title One tutor through
yes.
funds.
Yes,
correct.
Yes, we did discuss. I just wanted to know this. And
yes.
is that a full time position? Because I see two different that we talked about. I see two different.
That's different from what you have in front of you. What you voted on last month was so Shauna Coppola has resigned.
Mm-hmm.
You voted to continue funding her position, and then
mm-hmm.
you also. Added an additional 50% literacy interventionist, and that is the person that will be doing tier three, specifically with students with a dyslexic brain and other similar.
Yeah, 50
abilities.
Or 60? We talked about
50%.
50%.
Yeah.
Okay.
The literacy specialist is 60%.
Oh, that's 60%,
mm-hmm.
and then the Title One tutor is full time, right?
Would be full time, and it's a paraprofessional position, not a certified
yeah.
educator position.
Okay, I wanted that clarified too. So those are the things we are indeed. Other questions about the materials? Thoughts on that? I mean, I suppose we could open, if they're extra, we could open a black market. You know, Bob can be out.
At another school?
Yeah, we sell them. He can be out of school.
Put them on.
I think finding out if we could return them would be good information for us. But it really sounds like we need to do the right thing.
We don't want to hire people to do a job and not for them not to have the tools to do a job. That seems backwards. And it looks like we have the money to do it. Looks that way at the moment. Any advice?
I know it's hard because it's, you know, it just is so counterintuitive to take a closet and put everything in there. And it's not just materials. I mean, it's iPads, it's some other things too. And it just seems, but you know, again, as Kate said, you know, the indication is not, I wouldn't, if I was betting on this, I wouldn't bet on it because I just, you know, I don't, it's not the indication that we've been getting that you'll get this. So, you know, it's just, but it seems bizarre to put, you know, materials that kids need in a closet. So, I mean, if you can do it, then I think you need to support kids.
It's unfortunate that there's not more definite on funding, but funding has been really a lot of gray areas, and you know, everybody is just taking their best guess from the information we're getting from Concord. And I agree, it's not good.
Well, and this idea of having to put the items and materials in the closet, literally, just, you know, why don't they just say in a year, if it doesn't work out, return that then? I mean,
It is not unusual. Anything federally funded at the university, if the federal funds are withdrawn or for a reason not given, they come in and they check every serial number, everything. It has to be boxed up, taped.
Every audit, we have to do an inventory list of all of our items purchased with federal funds, and they track them and they make sure that we have them.
Well, they should have them sent. They should be sent back then.
Yes,
use them. They should use them elsewhere.
Well, I think that's why they give you that year in case the funding comes back. Because if you've already sent them back and you get your funding the following year, then you have to get those materials back. So that's why they give the year grace period.
We'd like to change this.
Yeah. We can't hear tonight. So I move that we appropriate $13,000 of this year's budget to purchase the needed materials for reading interventions.
The title one material. Does that motion cover it?
Does that cover that? I'll second.
Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right. Well, that budget balance isn't going to hold up for much longer. It's like we're getting, but it's all for good causes. All right. Anything other budget-related items, I think? Yes, Kate. I was thinking there might be a little bit more on this list.
So it's not for this year's budget, but I just think that at your June meeting, you have to be able to make a decision about whether or not you are going to fund a literacy tutor next year, because you have to post and hire for that position. So in June, you have to make a final decision. My assumption would be you're going to vote for it and they just purchase all the materials they're going to need. but it is something you would have to take an official vote on post-war because we would have to hire somebody for that position. Or we have to cut the person we currently have. I mean, there's just some decisions that have to be made if, in fact, we're not. The board is not going to fund it, even though I would imagine that you buy materials for the fund position.
Yes, and one of the things that I will point out is that next year's budget includes that position. I mean, it
most of it, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we didn't cut a position from next year's budget, so it's not as if it's going to be extra money that we have to find.
Yeah, you're going to make it full-time,
completely.
Yeah. Well, you would have to make
that's
it full.
That's right. Oh, what?
It's
yeah,
not
she
funded
was,
at 100%.
Okay.
Yeah, this isn't Shauna's position. I think this is a different separate.
I think it's actually a third out of the operating budget and two-thirds out of Title I funds that fund our current Title I tutor. I think that's what
okay.
we did the math. It was a
third
out of the operating budget and two-thirds out of Title I funds.
I wasn't sure of the breakout. Okay. So one-third is in the budget. We think it's one-third is in the budget.
No, I think she figured it was another an additional $15,000 if we're going to fund it, addition to what you already paid.
A third is already in the budget, and it seems like it's going to be about another $15,000.
Plus benefits.
Mm-hmm. Plus benefits.
Just retirement and FICA, because there's no benefits.
Right. And so we're talking about 2022, Thomas, maybe.
Because we talked about this
yeah.
some time ago. I
yeah.
thought it was like around
24.
Yeah. So that's money that we're going to need in extra budget that we don't currently have it put in.
Right, it's not in the budget. But correct.
That's what we're here for, to teach the children.
Yes, we're taking care of a lot of building needs this year. We need a decision on that relatively soon because we want to be posting and hiring, correct?
So we should do it soon.
I think you want the best person for the job and make us the closest decision you
can. As we think about next year's budget, I mean, there are some savings in the principal salary line. We know that already. That's about all we know already for next year.
Well, I think we have to do it.
Yeah. So, we're going to discuss it.
We move to fund the, what's it called?
Literacy tutor.
Literacy tutor for the next week.
Is there a second?
Yes, a second.
Discussion.
So we'll vote to fund this, but then if somehow we get our Title I funding back, it will apply to that.
Not to this position, no.
No.
Yeah, I don't think you're going to get Title I funding
right.
for a tutor,
right,
for
a
tutor position. If any funding, it will be very minimal funding. It will not cover a tutor, I don't believe. That is not the direction that we've been given.
Okay. It's good to know.
So maybe I'm confused too about what. So they just give us
yes, they give us an allocation.
They tell you how much can be spent on certain things. So they'll give you an amount, but then it's like, this amount can be spent on this, but you must use this amount for materials, and you must use this amount for...
No. Only certain things we have to set aside, not
right.
materials and things like that.
So I thought there was, for your homeless, you had to have a certain percentage.
For homeless,
like there are
there's certain categories. But
categories that say certain percentages of it that must be spent certain ways. And then you have some freedom
yeah.
within that.
Okay.
Like, isn't some professional learning too?
It depends on the grant
yeah.
and what you have to set aside.
So in the past, we have applied these monies to pay for...
The majority of your Title I funds pay for that portion of the tutor, and then a little bit of money for materials and things like that.
Okay, but you're thinking going forward, if we did get funding, we could or we couldn't do that again?
You could, but I don't think you're going to get the type of funding that would fund a tutor position.
$1,000, so if it's $1,000, it's not going to go very far.
I'm assuming that Caroline would use that for materials or something like that.
Okay. Great. Did that answer your question?
Mm-hmm. They're not happy answers, but they're answers.
Okay.
Any other discussion? Anything else anyone wants to add into that? Essentially, we're looking at an addition with the materials and the position. We're looking at a total of about another $36,000. See in the budget. We'll just have to keep a close eye on the budget next year.
The materials come out this year.
Oh, that's right. The materials come out this year. Thank you. Right. Thank you very much. That makes it much better what we have to look at for next year. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. So we will be. So just to recap,
We are looking to hire a literacy specialist at 60%, a literacy interventionist at 50%. This is just what we've talked about, the literacy tutor at 100%. Building aid, I thought we already had a building aid is on the list.
She retired this year, so we're just replacing her. It's not a new line.
All right. Okay, so it's not a new line, okay. And we already talked about the part-time custodian. We already approved of that, so that's in there. And paraprofessionals for 18-19, they're as needed as we go along. And then there's an anticipated opening for a special education teacher.
So it's something we have to talk about.
Okay, we'll talk about that at another time. Okay. All right. All right. Well, we're just spending money like crazy here tonight. All right. Does that conclude the budget?
Let's hope so.
Discussion. Any other questions or comments on budget or what? Okay. Just as a quick, Katie, we have a line called legal services. If you could change that to professional services, including legal and engineering, all kinds of stuff, because I know that we're doing a project that is going to have engineering services in it, rather than having to do, is it possible to do that, or does it have to?
You would have to add another line, because those are by function code, as given by the state of New Hampshire,
okay.
Yeah, Department of Ed, so we have to add a new line for that, under its own function and object code.
Okay. All right, then. Thank you, I just thought it was an easy change, apparently. All right, no other budget to discover. We're just going to move right on then. Principal search update. I guess the quick update is that we have an offer out. We are, offer has been made, offer is out. Still pending, I guess.
Especially.
I guess it's the right time. Is that the right way to put it?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Lunch prices. In our packets, this is something that we do every year. The federal government reimburses us for free and reduced lunch at a particular rate. They like us to try to get our price. They like us to show good faith that we are trying to get our price close to their price for one thing, for what we charge.
So we go
up 10 cents a year, and I don't know what they go up. So if you look at what is in the packet there, for free lunch, we get reimbursed $2.92. We are only charging our non-free lunch students, or whoever buys it, $2.60. So we're a solid 32 cents off, so we're going up by 10 cents, which is what we do pretty much every year. Otherwise, the government does not look favorably upon us because we're not charging.
We're making
a price. Yes, I guess.
Mm-hmm. 20 cents at a time.
Hey, it all adds up.
But how are our rates calculated? I mean, is that really based upon
our rates for? That's a good question. Our rates for the $2.60 that we charge now.
Right. How is that determined?
Does anyone know?
It's determined by you at this time. I mean, you can put it whatever you would like.
I'm wondering how much it costs. You know what I mean? What does it cost us?
Well, right now, your budget supplements your food service program because you don't make enough money here to fund it. So every year, there's that $12,000 line in your budget that you have to, because you have to make food service whole. So if it's in the hole, and every year you are, because you don't have the participation for one, and the food and the prices of the meals don't. They don't fund what it costs to run the program. So your budget supplements it. So
we really need to raise the price, is what you said.
I mean, it won't. Due to the small school, you'd have to raise it a lot in order to make this.
An $8 lunch.
There you go. I know she's so hard to make notes.
We can start having a little takeout window here or something. Got my potato tots.
Okay. All right, so do we need to make a motion of some sort?
Yes. That, the motion to increase our price from $260 to $270.
As she said, I can, yeah, I'll second.
Motion second, any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And I think now, perhaps more now to Ingrid's point, cafe services, which provides our lunches. So we contract out of the lunch program, the food program essentially. Breakfast is included in that, correct? So I mean, whatever breakfast we provide is included in that. So this is the breakfast, the free lunch, and anyway, they provide all of the food out of the kitchen. And every year we renew the contract, correct?
Yep. So you originally approved it, the whole contract in 2016.
Yes.
And each year you have up to 4 years additional renewals. So every year the state agency requires us to for you to renew it and approve it, and then we can sign the renewal and send it to them.
Yes. And this $44,000 reflects what the contract said. It's not an additional $44,000.
Nope. This is the contract for next year. They are saying the projection is you will have to fund $13,000. That's what they project out, that you will be short at the end of the year.
Which is
the $12,000 that you budget every year for to meet that goal.
Yep. Do people understand that?
Yes.
All right. Then a motion to renew
make a motion to renew the cafe services contract.
Okay, second.
Andrea. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Moving right along, old business, community connections. First of all, I'd like to thank on behalf of the board, I'd like to thank the folks who showed up Monday and put balloons out and delivered cupcakes, and you guys did a nice job. I came by the next day to sort of walk through and see things, and they still look good, those balloons. So you guys did a nice job.
All right.
And we got in early. We got in on the first day, so they weren't already full of sweets.
Correcting my daughter, which teacher appreciation. Appreciation.
Any other community connection updates? I know folks have been busy. Okay. Marshfield contract items, I don't think we have. We have a running list of Marshfield contract items. Lori has it somewhere.
Yeah,
it's somewhere, so you'll inherit that. and you'll inherit it because it's time to think. Next year is time to start thinking about. While we have a 10-year contract, we will be in our fourth year next year, and that's the time to start talking about moving for the following year. So we'll talk more about that as summer unfolds. And late start time in Marshwood, I think.
Well, I didn't attend the last meeting, but they did put out another survey. you might have received it.
Yeah, three options.
Yes, and I think I pretty much went over of them all. I can forward the letter to you if you want to include it. But yeah, I think basically they're asking people the same three options that we discussed. No change at all, a 20-minute later start time, and flipping the schedule. So a little bit different wording than I think what we discussed in our last meeting. But flipping elementary and middle school and high school students to start. And so they're putting the survey out. I just received it, I think, a week ago, 2 weeks ago. letter's dated April 27th, actually, but not too long ago.
So, and they're not rushing into anything.
They're not rushing into anything, no. And the letter talks about, you know, all the reasons why not to. They did pretty well listing all the pros and cons, mm-hmm. and they gave provided links to the research, and so there's a lot in there. People want to read it.
And I don't know how many on the board or anyone in the community got a chance to notice in Foster's SAD 35, they are cutting a position. They are cutting a couple positions, I think, in the middle school. And Dr. Nash made note of the fact that there will be 11 additional Rawlsford students there, because we'll have a full complement. Next year will be our first year of a full complement of all of our 7-12 students will be there, and she sort of made note of that. And she's actually hoping to earmark that money for some special, I think, after-school programs or something. The fact that they're going to be getting that extra $100,000 or so. Mm-hmm. And so she's finding a way to use that money to enhance some of the other education over there. That's kind of nice. We're going to have a very big senior class next year at Marshwood, 32 students. I mean, we haven't had a 32-student class, I think, ever go through. So I don't know how it grew between the time they left here and got there, but it grew. So,
yeah, it was 15 kids year one.
That's right.
It grew.
There were kids they hadn't accounted for in the budget because they came out of the woodwork. All right, that's probably it. Okay. All right, future meeting dates. There are a couple of three MSAD 35s. Our next board meeting is June 14th. Kate very nicely had it on the calendar, sixth grade recognition is the night before that school board meeting. It will be the first one that I miss in my tenure as a school board member. I'm hoping that some of you will be able to go, and whether or not you
have a sixth grade or so,
then you'll be there. Good.
Crying at
that. That's right. You will not be forced to sit where the board sits, where I sit, because you know most of you are sitting with the kids. I usually sit with the superintendent when at those meetings, but so anyway, it's always the school does a great job. It's a wonderful event. Any other events that we're missing?
Graduation.
Summersworth graduation and Marshwood graduation are not on here, but Summersworth graduation was noted as June 15th. I'm pretty sure. I mean, Don Austin has said publicly that certainly Rawlsford is welcome to come as long as we have students there. This will be our last year, so if there's
I
someone,
did it last year.
Are you volunteering to do it again this year?
No.
What is the date again? Did you say
attending graduation and helping Don
right
Austin?
There.
I'll do it.
Oh,
well, they're going to think that I go there.
Hmm?
His youthful parents. He's concerned they might think that this is a senior.
He's a student citizen of money.
So Aaron, that would be great.
Okay.
Where is it this year?
I just need to
So Lori can give you
we usually get invitations. I'm sorry.
It's the same as last year, right?
Last year, it was at because the WIT was being renovated,
but
it's
back
at the
WIT.
And it actually goes relatively quickly. The hardest thing is finding a parking spot on campus.
It's get there early. Trust me. And once you tell the security people that you're a part of the, then you'll have no problem parking.
Graduation. Yeah.
That's what I did.
The hardest part is finding where the gowns are being kept and where you have to go up to put on your gown to walk in with the To process.
To process.
That is scary, Barry.
That's all, that's all right. You'll just, you know, follow Don Austin. You can sit up there. You get to sit on stage.
I don't have to say anything, right?
No.
Just a small briefing for parents.
30 minutes tops.
Yeah.
Stand up and rest the microphone away from the house. Thank you, Aaron. I think that would be, it's a nice touch to,
It's such a cheer on Bailey, and he can use them.
Really, it's all Victoria, and she'll be.
It's beautiful.
She'll be speaking, so. Yeah, that'd be really nice.
Beautiful thing to be part of.
Really nice indeed.
Hopefully it doesn't happen, what happened last year, because they had a, we were up on the stage, and there was a step off right next to me, and they were supposed to have somebody, because I was facing the graduates, and the bones, and a couple of them just went.
Oh, no.
So they had to quick get somebody over there.
Welcome to the room.
Those athletic scholarships, I think I canceled.
Fractures.
It's amazing. But it is, I mean, it's nice to, it's nice that we can be there for our last time. I'm working on the insert to the Salmon Falls Quarterly, which the school named, you know, and which I always point out, it goes out twice a year. I just love that. It's just like so small town. I am noting that this is essentially the end of a over 5 decades of partnership with Summersworth for 7th through 12th education, and that we are continuing the partnership at the SAU level, but no longer at the educational level. And it's a big, it's over 5 decades. It's a long. It's been quite a partnership, sir. Yep.
All right. If I can go attend, I will.
Any school events you want to mention, Kate? Did a nice job on the calendar.
Yeah, and they're all on our Google Calendar through our webpage, so they're available for families, and they'll be, as there always is, that we send the calendar home, double-sided paper, and it's on Facebook, and just so families know all the events that come up over the next 6 weeks.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Closing comments by visitors. Celia
Leopold. I wonder if the late start committee would consider talking to the elementary school parents. I know it's something that's happening at the high school level, but it would impact kids with parents with children in both schools. And
that would be a great question to take to Marshwood, because they are the people working on it. We have an honorary seat at the table.
They actually, I believe that's the survey went out to elementary parents as well. It may not, I think on Marshwood, in Marshwood, that are attending Marshwood schools.
It may not. We have separate buses, here. Right? So it wouldn't necessarily affect elementary.
From my experience, personally, we did the third option where the elementary school started before the high school, and the high school got out earlier, so that it provided parents who had older children a chance to have childcare for their younger children as an option. And I also wanted to reiterate to the board, I know I brought it up at last meeting or one of the previous meetings, that it would be nice for the board to consider and the new staff to consider ensuring that there's enough school time so that we're not changing the school hours partly through the year like we did this year.
Yes, please talk to the snow gods. your point is well taken. Thank you, sir.
Just a reminder to talk about it over the summer.
Other comments by visitors? Seeing none, comments by board members?
Can I just add one?
Yes.
I forgot to mention during my report that yesterday we had the walkthrough for the roof replacement.
Oh, yes.
So we had 4 vendors come. The bids are due next week, and we'll be getting those back next week. Kate, you did thank you to them. They did the walkthrough.
Yeah, thank you for that. I knew that it was in the works, and I hadn't realized. We weren't sure we were going to get the vendors coming in. So congratulations on that. And that's the annex and the kindergarten roof. Excellent. Thank you. All right, we do.
do have non-public, so a motion to go into non-public, please.
I think motion to go into non-public for this.